You need to know how to use these apps because it's a double-edged sword. While we do admit that there is a lot of goodness that comes out of it, there is a lot of evil, and we have to admit that too. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, if you scroll your favorite social media app, you would be scrolling for a lifetime. Do you know that? And you still won't be able to watch all the videos and clips and posts that have been posted there on that app by everyone on earth. So if I were to ask you to say out loud your favorite app, can you say it? YouTube, Instagram, someone else? Twitter, TikTok. I see the guys on the side there saying TikTok. Yeah. Okay, can I tell you? The most popular one on earth is... I can't believe you don't know. Don't pretend. Everyone's pretending here. The most popular app on earth is? I can't. Okay. I see there's chaos. So, the most popular app on earth is TikTok. Right. If you were to scroll TikTok, guess what? It keeps ticking and talking. TikTok, right? It just keeps going. It keeps going. And you know what? It has all sorts of things on there, good things and bad things, and a lot of waste of time. Neither good nor bad, but it just took up your time. So, like I said at the beginning, if you were to scroll your favorite app, you'd probably end up scrolling through the night. You won't realize it's time of Fajr. You'll keep scrolling. You won't realize the sun has risen. You keep scrolling. You might feel hungry, you might need the loo. You'll get up to go to the loo and come back and keep scrolling. And some of us will take that with us to the loo. Am I right? All of you who said, yeah, you're guilty. May Allah bless us. But take it with you to the loo, sitting comfy on this little chair, meaning it's not a chair, but on the toilet seat and busy scrolling. If I were to ask you a show of hands, but I won't. A lot of hands would be up to say, yes, I'm guilty of scrolling while on the loo. Yet on the loo, is it something that a Muslim should be doing? Sitting on the loo and you're busy doing your thing and you're busy watching? What's happening, man? Subhanallah. But this is a reality we need to talk about because it's happening and it's happening to good people as well. Do you agree? MashaAllah, I'm glad people agree. So, doesn't that mean that as much as we would like to make use of this technology, we need to have some form of guidance and follow it? Some limit. We need to set ourselves the limits as well. It cannot be that every day you are losing track of time because it's very magnetic. It's definitely something that is addictive, to say the least. If I can tell you that I have to be very disciplined in order to get off some of these platforms, I can only imagine what it's like for some of the youngsters out there. Some of those who might not be able to be as disciplined. You would get up in the morning without having really slept at night, and you are groggy through the day and you're upset with the real people around you simply because you were just scrolling and laughing at your screen at a time when you were meant to be asleep. And do you know that at the moment, we have not just the coronavirus, but we have what is called Omicron, right? And you need to have an immune system that is a little bit stronger, and that will not happen if you haven't slept properly. And if you're going to be on your phone, you're not going to be able to sleep properly. So what's going to happen? You're more likely to get sick and ill and you're wondering why, but you're not sleeping on time. And if you take a look at the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. What does he encourage us to do at night? What does the Quran tell us to do at night? The Quran says that Allah created the night for us to rest. Yes, there are exceptions. You have a guard, you have people who need to work at night, you have someone who has something important to do at night. It's not prohibited. Allahu alladhi ja'ala lakum al-layla litaskunu fihi wan-nahara mubsira. It's Allah who created the night in order for you to rest in. In order for you to achieve that comfort in. And he created the day such that you can see in it. So that's why you work. That's why you get up and you do things during the day. Allah wants you to get up in the morning for Salatul Fajr. That's not possible to happen unless you sleep on time. So let's realize that we have beautiful guidance. Number one, you need to know how to use these apps, because it's a double-edged sword. While we do admit that there is a lot of goodness that comes out of it, there is a lot of evil, and we have to admit that too. And in the middle, there is a lot of that which just wastes your time, wasting time. It's up to us to know how to follow, who to follow, what to do, how to close your eyes. Because do you know what? Speaking to some of the youngsters, they say, and I've asked the question, listen, you know what? You are on this platform, okay? What do you find interesting in it? Well, you know what? It's all so interesting. It's been made that way. If you notice, a lot of the apps have now tried to come on par with this scrolling. And they have a little clip. It differs, the amount of seconds differ. Some 15, some 30, some a little bit more, and so on. And it just keeps going. Why? Because they need you there. So what will keep you there? That which is a waste of time, futile. I promise you, people are very, very, very sad in their real lives. And they begin to believe that the only happiness they're getting is from the screen and from social media, just by watching, not realizing it's not the real life. It's a virtual life. I'm not even going to go into metaverse, because it's actually something that's new, but it's taking the globe by storm. They want to replace everything that you know in reality into something virtual and take you there so you can spend your lifetime there. Your body needs physical movement. That's a reality. Your body needs rest. That's a reality. Allah tells us that if you are disciplined, you will be able to lead a healthy life. And you know, if you're healthy in terms of your body, your mind will also be healthy. And then the way you speak to people, you're not snappy because you've had a good sleep, you've had a good rest, you've eaten healthy, you exercise well, you're okay, and therefore you speak with a lot of patience, and you speak to the people around you with good words and goodness, and mashallah, it helps you. But no, we are snappy. Why? Because there is a problem. If someone were to search, why is this person so snappy? Why are they speaking so abruptly? Why are they so impatient? Why do they get angry so quickly? Why are they screaming and shouting so fast? A lot of it goes down to social media, the way we use it, because it has a skittle effect that is studied. People deny it. We are here talking about it because we love you enough, and ourselves as well. We have to make sure, subhanallah, that we follow what Allah has asked us to do. And it's not difficult. And it doesn't mean don't enjoy. Enjoy it, but within limits. One thing that I always like to remind people about is the most real thing. What do you think it is? If I were to ask you, what is that one thing that's definitely going to happen to you? What is it? Say it again. Death. Death. As Muslims, we're not scared or frightened, but we have to prepare for that day. It's going to be a beautiful day, inshallah. Beautiful to go back to your Lord, meet your Lord. Imagine. I mean, we're not going to let our health be wasted just because you say, oh, I heard it's going to be a beautiful day, and so therefore I'd like to get there like tomorrow morning. No. But the reality is,
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu,
O you who believe, ittaqullaha, be conscious of Allah, develop a beautiful relationship with your Lord.
وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ,
each one of you should look into what you have prepared for tomorrow. What have you prepared for tomorrow? When you're going to meet your Lord, you need to take something with you. What did you stand for on earth? Was it something good or something bad? I spoke once about social media, a few times, but once I said that Allah will show you your own clips and you'll be asked to watch them and then decide where you'd like to go. How's that? People got upset with me. How do you know? Why? Hey, relax. If you're getting angry with me, you're doing something wrong. You should be proud of what you've done. And if you're not, stop it. Do something else. It's a fact. I'm going to meet Allah. And Allah says,
Iqra kitabak.
He will say to you, read your deeds. Read your own book of deeds. Do you not think that this is part of your book of deeds? What you did on TikTok and Instagram and everywhere else, and what you might be doing perhaps on Twitter and on Facebook and whatever else it may be. Nobody is saying don't use it. All we're saying is when you arrive on the day of judgment, you are going to be shown what you did without a doubt. Allah doesn't lie. You're going to be shown what you did. So all your moves, mashallah, you're going to be shown them. The last time I did this, people say, Mufti has moves. Mashallah. My moves were not in sync with anything. You know, when I see, and honestly, as we scroll, and I'm a part of the social media, I'm sure you know that. And sometimes you do see things, okay? And as you scroll and you think to yourself, imagine the effort that is put in order to get this clip done. Wallahi, if you had to put a fraction of that effort in trying to improve your recitation of the Quran, you'd be the best qari in the whole world. I promise you. Do you know how addictive it is? Look, a guy like me, and like I said, the gloves are off. I don't want to sugarcoat anything here. A guy like me, sometimes as you're clicking, do you know how you quickly flick away from something you don't really want to be involved in, right? So you flick away. That's how it should be. And I'm saying this because let's face reality. I'm not going to tell you don't use this, although you need to be very disciplined. But I'm going to say if there's something and you're flicking it away because you don't really want to go into it, you hear the first two or three words. Do you agree? You hear the first two or three words. And sometimes the next one has similar words, and the next one has similar words, and the next one has similar words. And guess what? Those words begin to ring in your mind when you're going down to recline in your bed at the end of the day. And you think to yourself, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. When words of Allah should be ringing in my mind, all those words I heard are ringing even louder. I felt that. Imagine what those who are dedicated in this would be feeling. They would spend the whole day behind 30 seconds of words. And they would be practicing. I've been speaking to a lot of people in order to try and understand good people, very good people. And they'll tell you, we practice for a day, 2 days, before we then post ourselves doing the same or similar. I'm not saying all of it is bad. I'm talking of that which is dirty and ugly in its wording and perhaps even pornographic in its words. Remember, pornography is not just that which you view in terms of porn, but even that which you hear in terms of vulgarity to the degree of pornography. So you need to realize, as a believer, where do you stand? Or the question I asked earlier, am I going to be able to watch this in front of Allah on the day of judgment? And it's going to happen. It's going to happen, mashallah. Allah says,
اقرأ كتابك كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا.
Evidence that you're going to be shown all your videos, all your clips, all your posts, and you're going to be told, decide for yourself. Where do you want to go? Where do you think you deserve to go?
كفى بنفسك اليوم عليك حسيبا.
You can make a judgment against yourself today. That's what Allah says. So you're going to be shown this. And this is why the ones who used all of this wrongly, do you know what they're going to say? And I know people got upset with me when I said this the last time, to say, who are you to judge? I'm not judging. Allah, I'm not judging. We judge ourselves. I don't want to judge anyone. I love everyone. To be honest with you, those who don't fulfill their salah, those who perhaps don't even dress appropriately, those who don't, there may come a time when they would be at a point turning to Allah, perhaps more than I have or will, and others as well. Who am I to judge? But am I not allowed to just remind, to say, guys, this is not the right thing actually, or think about it? You can word it nicely. If I tell you, think about it, that's what I'm doing today. I'm just telling you, think about it. Is it wrong? Am I judging? The answer is no. Listen to what Allah says.
وَوُضِعَ الْكِتَابِ.
On the day of judgment, the book is put. Whose book? Your books. Your book is put in front of you. What type of deeds? Allah says, there's the book. Read it yourself and decide where you want to go. So Allah says,
فَتَرَى الْمُجْرِمِينَ مُشْفِقِينَ مِمَّا فِيهِ وَيَقُولُونَ يَا وَيْلَتَنَا مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا.
The criminals, meaning the people who were sinful, they used their time wrongly. They didn't turn back to Allah after turning away from Allah. That's an important way of wording it. Those who did not turn back to Allah after turning away from Allah, but rather turned away from Allah and forgot about Him and forgot about the day that they were going to meet Him. What will they say? They will look at this book and they will say, what is up with this book? It hasn't left anything. Nothing small nor big. Everything is here. Every deed is in this book. What's wrong? How come Allah's brought the smallest thing here? In other words, Allah is telling us, you know what? The smallest of your deeds and the biggest of your deeds will all be in the book. So I have a problem. And so do you. What is the problem? I need to delete some stuff that I've done. And you have the same problem because you're just a human being living in the same era. So in the same way that I have things to delete, you too would have things to delete because, like I said, we're using the same platforms. What to do? Well, you do two things. Number one, seek the forgiveness of Allah. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, grant me forgiveness. Guide me. Oh Allah, open my doors. Oh Allah, strengthen me. And at the same time, make a difference by changing. If you seek the forgiveness of Allah and you're not interested in change, then that forgiveness is flawed. But if you seek the forgiveness of Allah and you're trying to change, then you're heading in the right direction. Even if you fall again, no problem, come back again. Each time you do the wrong thing, you should have regret in your heart. Each time you did the wrong thing, you fell into watching the wrong stuff or posting the wrong thing. Wallahi, you should feel saddened in your heart that, you know what, I did the wrong thing. On the day of judgment, I will not be able to present this. Some people say, and I've spoken to a lot of people, and the reason why I do, especially the youngsters, is because we want to know what's going on and we want to help. And they'll say, look, I'm not doing the haram stuff, but I'm just doing like just haram stuff, you know. Now, that's a statement I've heard. What do you mean? I guessed that what they meant was I'm not doing a major sin, but just a minor sin. Okay? That's probably what they meant. I'm not doing the haram stuff, but I'm just doing the haram stuff, you know? And I'm thinking to myself, okay, let me ask you another question. And this is a powerful question for tonight. Do you know that on the day of judgment there will be a scale? Do you know that your good deeds will be placed on the right, your bad deeds on the left? So I want to ask you a question. You know that you have deeds, okay? How many good deeds have you packed away that you can actually say, okay, I might have done, like the guy says, haram stuff, but I've done thousands and thousands of good things. I've prayed 5 times a day without missing. I read Quran every day. I actually did charities every day. I did so many good deeds every day. I kept the people who were making a noise in the back quiet by saying, shh, shh. That was also a good deed. MashaAllah. May Allah reward you guys, whoever it is. Wow, dead silence. Whoever did it is blessed, man. May Allah grant you Jannah without reckoning, man. Because I don't want to see my book. I'll be too embarrassed. So we ask Allah to give us Jannah without reckoning. Say Ameen. We would be embarrassed if we saw our own book. So one of the tricks is to bypass that by saying, oh Allah, give me Jannah without reckoning. Through your mercy. Don't even show me my deeds. Imagine my deeds. I'm going to just be, oh no, man. You know? My brothers, my sisters, you have a Lord who's merciful, very kind and forgiving. What He wants from you is to at least to make an effort. That's what it is. Make an effort, even if it is a small effort. You must make an effort. So here goes. We seek the forgiveness of Allah and we keep trying. And then, like I said, the question, the golden question, the most powerful thing that I feel I would say tonight is, pack away as many good deeds as you can so that when the scale is placed in front of you and you start seeing, okay, there's a lot of bad coming. Okay, now let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, the good is coming in. Ooh, you can start smiling. Why? Because I see more good than bad. And that's what it is. So how many times do you read your Shahada? Shahada is not only for people reverting to Islam. It's for Muslims to read on a daily basis several times a day. Did you know that? No. Why? Because we didn't. Well, now you know. Repeat your Shahada. Renew it, refresh it, reiterate it, repeat it. It's the most powerful statement that you can utter. But it should come from the heart. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So do good deeds, your adhkar. How many good deeds have you done? Sometimes, and this is why I say, when you ask the brother or the sister, well, look, you've done a few things that you're not very proud of, right? How many things have you done that you are very proud of? Do they outnumber these or not? If they do, keep it going and keep increasing it and don't decrease it. One thing I've learned is when you do not compromise your salah, you go very far in life. You hear that? When you don't compromise your 5 daily prayers, you go very far in life. And that's not easy. But if you're determined, they say where there is a will, there is a way. If you're determined, you will get there. So learn to increase these deeds by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you have no such deeds, then who do you have to blame? The only thing you have in your life, the main focus is around social media in a way that's a waste of time. I'm not even talking about the haram, okay? We're just talking about the haram, right? Something that's just a waste of time, and that was your main focus. You spent your energy, your resources, your time, whatever else it was, your money, your effort, your brains, everything. Behind what? This. Fair enough. Nobody's going to tell you that it's haram, right? I hope you know the difference now. But it may be haram and it may not be haram, depending on what exactly you're doing. However, ask yourself, is this enough for me to meet Allah with? That's a good question. It shouldn't frighten you to the degree where you get depressed. No, it should just give you a bit of a wake-up call. That's all. A bit of a wake-up call to say what? I'm going to meet with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I'm going to show Him, oh Allah, I tried to do this for You, Your sake. I tried to do that for Your sake. Now, People say, okay, yes, yes, we helped the poor people on our street for a whole year. You know, we fed them. And when COVID, when the lockdown happened, we went around door to door giving people food and looking after them. And people might say, well, I was there out in the front line and I did this. Fair and good. Those are all good deeds. But hang on. Allah says the most loved deeds to me are which deeds? Which deeds? Who knows? Which deeds? You said it so loud it was no longer a secret. Anyone else? Which deeds do you think Allah loves the most? Consistency, regularly, secret deeds. I'm looking for something. Yes? At the back. I still haven't got the answer I want. It's a hadith Qudsi. Allah says there is nothing more loved to me that a slave could do than the deeds that I made compulsory on him. Did you ever hear that? So if someone says, which deeds does Allah love the most? You got to say that which is farad. If he didn't love it, he wouldn't have made it farad. So what is it? Your salah, that which is compulsory, just the compulsory bit of it to begin with, and then you expand on it. Allah says, that I love the most. So yes, it's good to help everyone. It's good to be on the front line. It's definitely something encouraged and taught in Islam. It's something that you must be doing. And yes, you will definitely be rewarded for it. But you need to know, don't lack in that which Allah loves the most. That's your prayer. That's your fasting. That's your charity to the poor. Help people with your finances. Become a better person. You know, a lot of the times marriages break because people don't know how to use social media. You're sitting and watching everyone else. Hey, mashallah, subhanallah, la ilaha illallah. All your dhikr is coming out, but for the wrong reasons. The wrong reasons. You're watching the wrong things and you're saying all these words, praising Allah. Do you know what you're doing here? And you realize what you're looking at and what you're saying are two opposite poles. You should be saying, astaghfirullah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, etc. In fact, you shouldn't be there. You should, if there is something, you know, it's just like walking on a street. If there is something that you're not supposed to be looking at, you know, and you happened to, your gaze happened to pass by, you know, you control it, you look down. You may want to say a word in remembrance of Allah, but the minimum is you look down and you carry on doing your thing. Subhanallah. The same would apply online. People say, how could you be on there? There's so many haram things there, you know. Hang on. We don't dwell on it. The first nadra, it would apply on social media as well. Which means the first glance that happened, okay, fair enough, flicked it. It is dangerous, I do agree. Because you know what shaitan does? He makes you want to follow, to find out. You see a lot of the guys here, they follow all these girls, right? Even some of the older guys, they follow all these girls. You know what? My brother, you're living a fantasy, man. These people don't even want to look at your face. They don't even want to know who you are. They're honestly there just to make themselves feel good. I'm not going to discuss whether what they're doing is haram or halal because they may not even be Muslim. But at the end of the day, you've got all these follows. The only thing that's going to happen to you is on the day of judgment, right? Come here. Who did you follow on TikTok? Here's all the names. Who were these? You can't say Sheikh Beyonce, Sheikh. These are not Sheikhs. MashaAllah. So if you focus on the right people and you follow them and you set the settings of your app in a way that you will mainly see what you've asked to see, then you're disciplined. So you follow good things. It doesn't all have to be directly connected to, you know, something to do with knowledge, but maybe something else. You might want to learn some cooking. You might want to do something. You might have an interest or two in life. You may follow certain people who may teach you those things. But if something's going to become vulgar and pornographic, what do? You don't follow. If something is a waste of time, you follow? You don't follow. And you can set your settings in a way that you don't need to be suggested things. Because I don't want to. I tell you why. When you are suggested all sorts of things, what happens? You start the scrolling game that we spoke about right at the beginning. And it doesn't end. The scrolling game does not end, and guess what? All of us are in it without much exception. Unless you belong to a different generation altogether. But nearly, let's word it this way, nearly all of us are in it. The scrolling game, it needs discipline. You need to know what you're doing here. You need to make sure that you actually do the right thing. So here we are speaking about that which is farad, which Allah wants you to do. And then we're speaking about how to create a balance, because yes, as much as I do certain things that might not be beneficial, am I doing beneficial things that I'm going to present in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I see people nodding their heads, inshallah, I hope we are. And then you don't go to sujood with your phone at the back and say, Allahu Akbar, you know, and say, see how long I'm taking in sujood. You know, you don't do that. Some people do that. Recently, I was out for Umrah. So one of the guys was telling me that, you know, it would be nice to let the world know that it's quite easy to go and make Umrah right now. And it is open and the restrictions are very few and quite simple to actually fulfill. And so to encourage people, perhaps if people saw that you are here, they might be encouraged. I said, okay, how are we going to do it? He says, well, once you're finished, you can take a little video. So now I finished and I took a little video and I realized, you know what? The Kaaba is right in the back and it seems like I'm doing tawaf, but I'm not. In the sense that I finished. I was done with it. I had to put a disclaimer under there to say, you know what? I was done with my Umrah, by the way. I felt it because, in all honesty, perhaps I wouldn't like it. But then again, as a human being, It happened. And we all do things like this sometimes, where we don't when we think about it at hindsight, we think to ourselves, maybe I shouldn't have done this. But then it's done. It's over. Leave it and let it be. Maybe next time you can learn your lesson. I'm talking about myself. If that's the case, then I'm sure a lot of you would relate, because we're all human beings, to say, yes, we have done certain things and later on we feel, I shouldn't have done this. So what do? Well, if it's something haram, then you definitely have to turn to Allah, say, oh Allah, forgive me. And then you've got to attempt to delete what you did. Now, the problem we're facing today when it comes to social media is something very, very serious. It is the multiplication of the haram that started off by you, or that you participated in a way that you were involved in its initiation or spreading. And that goes back to a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ about someone who sets a good example, someone who sets a bad example. Both of them will be rewarded based on the example, either with good or with bad. When it is followed by others and spread right up to the day of judgment. So imagine you started something and it was bad and people followed it. And before you know, on a platform such as TikTok, you could clock 1 million views and perhaps 100,000 repeats and reposts in no time. The sillier it is, the more likes it gets. Have you noticed? The more vulgar and pornographic it is, the more reposts it gets. Swearing and all that. Thank you. I didn't say it. You said it, Habibi. It's true. It gets more. And you know what? Good people, mashallah, people in, you know, who look relatively decent, and you see the biggest swear word. Did I just hear that? Initially, we used to gulp. Nowadays, minor, that's still a small word. Because the big words are becoming small. They're new words now. Songs. So, you know, people were talking about prohibition of music and so on. You know what I say? The lyrics are so vulgar. No religion on earth. Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, all three of these actually prohibit those type of lyrics completely. But are we interested? Well, I tell you, we have to develop an interest in knowing what's right and wrong. Even if I've fallen in it or you've fallen in it, come on, it's time to at least try and improve yourself a little bit. Today we're seated here. I want to say something. Wallahi, I feel connected to this place. It's not the first time I've been here. I've been here a few times. And I want to tell you something. Faces I see, I recognize at times. But do you know there are so many who have attended our events who left us in the last 2 years? May Allah grant them Jannatul Firdaus. From your families, your friends, your relatives, those who've passed on, may Allah give them Jannah. And guess what? We could be next in line. Is it impossible? It's not impossible. That's why I say, all you got to do is just tell yourself, inshallah, I'm going to improve, even if it's 1 millimeter. If you leave this venue today, believing within yourself that I need to improve a little bit, at least we've succeeded. That's all we're asking for each other, even myself. I've spoken about very important matters, the issue of sleep, the issue of your health, the issue of discipline, the issue of what you're doing, how much you're doing, the issue of preparing to meet with Allah. You can say, oh Allah, I was stuck in this, but I tried to come out and I started improving bit by bit. But before I got to the end, I already passed on and I came to you. So you know what Allah will say? And this is all from Hadith, by the way, and Quran. Allah will say to you that, you know what? Because you had a firm intention to come out of this mess and you started and you were dedicated and focused and you began to achieve, even though you had just started when we took you away, we will reward you as though you ended and completed on the best possible note. Here is paradise for you. That's the mercy of Allah. Where do we get that from? We get it from the Hadith. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. All deeds are judged by their underlying intentions, and the reward that a person will receive is based on the intention. Whether you completed it or not is actually besides the point for Allah. When a person says, look, I'm going to give a charity of so much every day for the next year, and they start giving a charity and then they pass away halfway, do you really think the reward stops there? It doesn't. They save the money, it's going to go to the heirs. And they got a full reward for the whole year based on the intention. Wow. So when you intend to change, I'm going to change this. If you're involved in something sinful and you tell yourself, you know what, I'm going to put an end to it. I'm going to stop it in a nice way. I'm going to put brakes. I'm going to slow down. I'm going to make sure I improve for Allah. So at least you can meet Allah on the day. And Allah is not, you know, someone you should be frightened about in the sense that, oh, I can't even communicate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will communicate with you. You communicate with Allah. You talk to Him. You will tell Him on that day what you want to say. But He's your Lord. So there is the awe. Indeed, there will be. There is a sense of, obviously, the grandeur of Allah. Indeed. But there is love. There is kindness, all the qualities of Allah in place. You will have to explain, you'll have to explain yourself and talk to Him and say, you know what, I tried, even though He knows, and He knows it well, but He wants to hear it from you. Why? Because you need to bear witness against yourself. That's what it is. And that's why a man will come on the day of judgment and he will be shown his deeds. And he will have... By the way, a lot of the women get happy when they hear this. They say, at least it wasn't a woman, right? Because when they talk about the last person getting into Jannah, it's always a man. Have you noticed that? The last man to get to Jannah. What does that mean? The women were better. They were there before him. MashaAllah. It's a way of looking at things. So this man will come up and he will be shown his deeds. Do you deny any of these deeds? So he looks at these deeds and there are files full of deeds. From the east to the west, he sees number one, number two, number three, number four, files full of deeds. His deeds are all recorded, registered. 99 files full of bad deeds. Do you deny any of this? And he doesn't deny it, because you can't deny it. How are you going to deny it? You can't deny. Here in this world, you can deny. A person saw you stealing the cake at the back and said, did you steal it? No, not me. It wasn't me. And they show you the CCTV. So I think this camera has been a little bit edited. Someone's been tampering. Come on, it's you. But on the day of judgment, there's nothing like that. Nothing like that. So no denial. And suddenly, the hadith says, suddenly a card falls out of one of the files. This hadith is known as the hadith of the card. And so, when the angels take that card and they are instructed to put it on the scale of good deeds because it says there, the shahada, that this man had uttered in his life once with true belief in it. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. This will be put on the right side of the scale, and guess what? It will be heavier than those 99 folders from the east to the west, full of bad deeds. And this man will be forgiven by Allah and told to go to Jannah. Isn't that the mercy of Allah? If you're facing a Lord like that, come on, come on. I mean, some of the youngsters would probably say, I don't think I'll make 99 files, maybe 98. You know, we might make less, maybe 70, 80 files. But anyway, to be honest, all it means is your whole life is there. But you're facing a Lord who's merciful. But have you really said, Ashhadu Allah ilaha illallah in your life, even once? With true conviction, I bear witness there is none worthy of worship besides my Maker. And I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger sent with the message. So what he gave us was meant to be for us as guidance. I bear witness. I believe that. If you have good news to you, that statement is powerful. Hence, earlier I said every day we should be repeating this. At least if one of them is accepted, you're successful. It's called the dhikrullah. Remember Allah. So my brothers and sisters, inshallah, we can improve. And inshallah, we can grow the obedience of Allah. And like I was saying, the bad deeds are multiplied and we get the sin of it, and everyone who actually spread it and everyone who practiced on it and everyone who continued it right up to the end on Qiyamah, and that becomes hectic. So what should we do? Seek Allah's forgiveness and try to delete your bad footsteps. Try to delete them. Some people can't. I've known people who have been crazy online, crazy, and then they make tawbah and their craziness goes. And they've asked me, what should I do? It's very important to hear this, because many of us might fall into the same thing on a smaller level. What should I do? I've been using my social media or whatever else to do silly, crazy, haram, haram, haram things. Now that makes it a bit more, right? So the answer is, my beloved brother, my beloved sister, I tell you, try to delete. You may not be able to, because obviously it's free for all to repost, and if they enjoyed it, they would, and probably sometimes, depending on what field you were in, it might be copyrighted to someone else and you don't know how to get out of that agreement. Okay, it can happen depending on how professional you were in it. It's not the end of the world, for as long as you ask Allah's forgiveness and then you promise to try and undo some of that, and you lead a life where you're trying to undo some of that, Allah will grant you Jannah and Allah will forgive you. So say there was a lot of bad. We tried to delete, we couldn't. So we created something good and we multiplied it and we encouraged people in the right direction and we continued using it in a beautiful way. No swear, no curse, no insult, no matter what. You don't teach the deen by insulting people. You don't teach the deen by cursing others. You don't teach the deen by punching people in the face with your words. You don't do that. You do it in a beautiful way. So inshallah, if 100,000 people were astray because of something you said or did, and 20 million found the path because, or were moved in the right direction because of something you said, on the scale, what will happen? What will happen on the scale? Inshallah, if there was sincerity, Allah Almighty will grant you Jannah. He's going to overlook it. And that's why one of the biggest blessings that a Muslim has is that Allah weighs the deeds. فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. We've heard it so many times in the Quran. Whoever's good deeds are heavier, those are the ones who are successful. He doesn't say whoever doesn't have any bad deeds, because all of us have bad deeds, myself included. We have bad deeds. And we seek forgiveness. That which we remember, that which we don't remember. But we definitely need to do something about it. So if you've led a life that was in the wrong direction, start leading one in the right direction. Nobody is saying become a saint overnight. No. You might already be on a very high level in the eyes of Allah because of your struggles. Do you know that Allah judges you based on your ability, your capacity, and how much strength it took from you to do something to please Him? I give you a quick example. A simple example of a scarf on the head, okay? That's a very simple example, and I don't mean offense to anyone. If you're in an environment where everyone is wearing a scarf and it's everyone is there, your family, people are, you know, the people are wearing a scarf and the society, the community, everyone is on a similar level, mashallah, you definitely will be rewarded for doing the right thing because you did the right thing. Was it very difficult for you to do it? No, it wasn't. So you achieved a reward for doing what you had to do as a Muslimah. And you know what? Mashallah, tabarakallah, it was good. But now there's someone else with a similar scarf. But in an environment where the family doesn't practice, the people around you don't practice, they frown on you, she gets a bigger reward. And then there's someone else whom they try to remove it. They fight you, they hate you, they want to abuse you, and you still have, you get an even bigger reward. Why? Because the basic reward is there, but now you're getting more because of your circumstances. And the other one's getting even more because of the circumstances. So Allah knows that everyone, even in their practice of that which is compulsory, is actually different in reward. The basic reward of fulfilling the duty is done. But there is a bonus reward because of the extra sabr and patience you had to endure. And there is an even greater bonus reward because it was almost impossible. But you still did it for Allah in a beautiful way. That is Allah. He's just. Prayer. If you're in a room where people are praying, or you're doing things where, subhanallah, everyone's praying and everyone reminds you of prayer, and mashallah, you prayed with everyone, you get a reward. But when you're feeling lazy and no one around you wants to pray and you're the only one who gets up and mashallah, you prayed, you know what? Your duty is done, but you get a greater reward because the circumstances were very, very against what you had to do and still you did it. Similarly, maybe I should end on this note because we still have a few days ahead of us in different parts of the country. And I've been speaking for 50 minutes. I think I have still a few minutes, right? Do you know if you're scrolling? The scrolling we were talking about right at the beginning. You're scrolling and the time of salah enters. If you have set an alarm, or if you hear the reminder, or if you notice the time of salah has entered, and guess what? If you stop what you're doing, no matter what it is, and go to pray, wallahi, I tell you, you have entered a level of closeness to Allah that is next level. I promise you. Do you know why? To turn off a device where you're scrolling through the latest methods of technological advancement, where they're aiming at your brain and trying to hold you in and rope you in with the concentration and the interest and the entertainment, and they know what they're doing, and for you to still be able to say, Ashhadu Allah ilaha illallah. This is the time for salah. Put this away. Even if you were doing something wrong. You know, we're not talking of haram. We're talking of something haram. You dropped it, stopped it, closed it, did your wudu, did your salah, took your time with Allah, and you got back to your phone. I'm not condoning the wrong, but I'm trying to highlight the right. Do you get what I'm saying? I'm not condoning the wrong, but I'm highlighting the right. Through the blessing and the barakah of your punctuality on that prayer, Allah will help you overcome the wrong here. Why? Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. Salah, the prayer itself, will help you avoid that which is immoral and sinful. Salah will help you avoid that. So fulfill your salah. What am I saying here? use of social media needs to be such that time for prayer, stop, cut, chop. Go and pray, and you may come back later. The next time there's a... Imagine, I want to ask you a question, and I want to make myself feel guilty and all of us. Say you're scrolling, or say you're on the internet, and say there's something interesting happening, and you've got something, and you want to pee. You want to pee. What do? You go to pee. Many of us would take the phone with us. Some of us would not take the phone with us. Either way, you didn't allow your pee to be delayed. You don't allow your pee to be delayed, but you allow your salah to be delayed. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Did you hear what I just said? What a comparison, but it's a fact. And that's why I said I want to tell this to myself and then to everyone to make us feel guilty, because it's true. You want to, okay, let's word it more respectfully, right? The call of nature, we won't allow to be delayed, but the call to success by Allah, we allow that to be delayed. There we are. We worded it differently. You got it? May Allah strengthen us. These are facts, facts that we cannot deny. Now I want the pledge. What is the pledge? I want each one of us to pledge to Allah that we're going to be more responsible in the way we use social media. Do we make the pledge? No. Inshallah doesn't mean yes. Inshallah can actually mean no. It's either yes or no. I mean, do we make the pledge?
Yes.
Mashallah. Now we're speaking business. Because if you say inshallah, it means inshallah, we'll see about it. You know, when you say, will you come home? Say inshallah, that means I'm not coming. Read my lips. That's what it means. Sorry? May Allah forgive us all, myself included. I don't really do that. That's the reason why I'm asking the people, yes or no. And the pledge is for your own self. It's, you're not pledging me. You're pledging Allah. I mean, why do we have this type of a reminder and this type of an event? It's in order for us to improve ourselves, become better people, become better in our relationship with Allah and in our relationship with other human beings. And why I say both of these, because let me tell you, the people you meet on social media are important, but they're important on a tertiary level, not primary, not secondary. Primarily Allah. Secondary, those around you, real life people, human beings. Tertiary, the third layer of people, those you meet online and so on and whatever, that they are people. Sometimes they do need your help and so on. You would reach out to them, and mashallah, if it's a good thing, then mashallah, it will help you in the hereafter. So remember, if you are going to meet the third circle by compromising your second or first circles, you need help. You need help urgently. For example, I have so many friends online, but I don't get along with my own family members. I need help, or my family needs help. I have so many friends online, but I've got no relation with Allah. I need help, because Allah is primary. Then my family is secondary. And then the people I'm really close to are tertiary. It's easy for those online to be fake. They show you 30 seconds a day, or maybe 30 seconds three or four times a day. So you see 2 minutes of someone a day that they want to show you, be it on Snapchat, be it on TikTok, be it on Instagram, whatever else it might be. They show you a few minutes in the day and you feel so close to them. You feel like you were a part of their whole day. But the people who were a part of your real whole day, you've got no relation with them, nothing. You don't even speak to them. Put it aside. Talk to each other. I said it earlier in my session with Brother Faisal. I said, you know what? We have to talk to our family members. We have to have a meal together. Put aside your phones. Talk to each other. Smile at each other. Tell them how much you love them and how much they mean to you. Subhanallah. Speak to them and let it be give and take. Have a family rule. Talk to each other. Reach out to each other. Ask them how their day was. What they need, what they don't need. Make time for them. Go out, have a picnic. Go to the park, go out to have a meal and so on. Put your phone aside for a moment. No problem. There will be some people online who are your friends, you know, legal or illegal, which means legitimate or illegitimate. But some of them are your friends and they'll keep telling you, hey, where are you? Why are you not messaging? It's been an hour. I haven't heard from you. No problem. Don't worry. Never mind. It happens. It's okay. You know who I'm talking about? Yes, that person. Yeah. So They'll ask you all the time, you haven't messaged me, what's wrong, what's happening, you're chatting to somebody else, why have you forgotten me, what's wrong, what's oh, relax, I'm just leading my real life out around here right now. You got to be patient. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on all of us. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking to you and speaking to myself today, because what I said is advice that I need first, subhanallah. When you see me online tweeting at 2 a.m, you can say, hey, you're supposed to be in bed. MashaAllah. And guess what I'll tell you? I'll tell you I'm in Hong Kong. It's a different time zone. MashaAllah. Allah bless you guys and grant you goodness and ease. It's a beautiful topic. It's something that I thought I'd discuss in a way that would be palatable perhaps to the people, that you can understand it and you can have a little tapping on your back to say, listen, let's do the right thing, guys. Let's do the right thing. We know what's the right thing. And inshallah, we can use these platforms to benefit ourselves tremendously and to benefit others and to show them things. Did you know that even if you were to show people a recipe or how to cook or something of that nature, you'd get a reward for every time someone actually makes that food? Did you know that? Although it's not a direct like act of worship, so to speak, but it's an act of kindness that then becomes an act of worship. So inshallah, we hope that Allah Almighty looks at the good and grants us paradise and overlooks the bad and forgives us and still grants us paradise. Ameen. And looking forward to seeing you guys again sometime. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.